Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Esteban Glower, and I am the director and editor-in-chief of the Journal of Critical Legal Studies. Today, I have the pleasure of interviewing Professor Manuel del Valle. He is a professor of law at the Inter-American School of Law. Today, we will discuss the case of United States versus Vaello-Madero, where the Supreme Court ruled that Puerto Ricans are not entitled to equal protection under the Fifth Amendment of the U.S. Constitution. This case is about José Luis Vaello-Madero, a U.S. citizen who was born in Puerto Rico in 1954. In 1985, he moved to New York. In 2012, he began to receive supplemental security income in New York after suffering from a serious illness that left him disabled and unable to work. The SSI program provides monthly cash benefits directly to qualifying low-income individuals who are over 65 years old, blind, or disabled. In 2015, he moved to Puerto Rico to care for his wife. After living in Puerto Rico for 3 years, the Social Security Administration learned about his move to Puerto Rico, determined that Vaello-Madero was outside of the United States for 30 days, and therefore they terminated his benefits and sued him for the benefit money he received over the course of that three-year period. When José Luis Vaello-Madero was sued, he responded by claiming that excluding U.S. citizens who reside in Puerto Rico from the SSI program violated the Equal Protection Guarantee of the Fifth Amendment. Mr. Del Valle, thank you for being here today. My first question for you is, did José Luis Vaello-Madero have standing to bring this claim?
Great question. Nobody addressed that question at any level, district court, court of appeals, or Supreme Court. But before we get there, let's look at how we got here. Let's take a quick look. You look at this photograph, 1898, Puerto Rico is about to be acquired by the United States or has been acquired by the United States per the Spanish-American War. See, it says Puerto Rico pig. We're just one more item on the menu to be taken over by an American empire. Here, Puerto Rico is made out to be a black figure. And why do these things matter here? Because the cases that we're talking about, these insular cases that involve the American empire, and you see Puerto Rico again, being an infant, being tutored by the Americans. What's odd about here, Puerto Rico is sitting down here in class. What's odd about these scenarios is that Puerto Rico had already had a history of 500 years by the time it was taken over by the Americans. It had a Spanish legal system, which was operational, had an economy, had become a province of Spain, had delegates to the Spanish Cortes. And none of those attributes would be available to it under American rule, even today. So the reason they're there is that they bespeak the question of equality. And that's the underlying basis for these claims. Equality versus the inequality experience under the Territorial Clause. Article 4, Section 3, Clause 2 of the U.S. Constitution, known to every Puerto Rican as 432. Now, to get to your question, standing, you know that in order for you to bring a case in an Article 3 court, and since 1966, the U.S. District Court of Puerto Rico has been Article III court. Therefore, the judges have had lifetime tenure since then. You have to show you've been harmed. So what was the claim here and what was the harm? The claim, the overarching claim, was that Puerto Ricans should be entitled to SSI benefits. And to do that, they should be able to apply for it and receive these SSI benefits. problem with Vaello-Madero was he was already receiving these benefits. So if you're already receiving the benefits, how do you stand in the shoes of those Puerto Ricans who never had a right to? So that's one issue. If you look at it from that perspective, then there is a question about standing, which the court ignored, and which all of the courts have ignored. So what actually happened here? If you look at the case from the Social Security perspective, which really is not presented in any of the opinions, it's, as I was a former chief administrative law judge, the Social Security Administration in San Juan, this is a process I'm very familiar with. So question number one, what didn't Vaello-Madero get before this enforcement action? He was supposed to receive notices in Spanish. None of that is in the record. And the notices in Spanish would have told him he was entitled to a hearing on this $28,000 allegedly overdue. That's not in the record either. Not only was he entitled to a hearing, he was entitled at that hearing to request that the government waive its demand for the $28,000 because he couldn't pay it. That would have shut down, assuming he got the waiver, that would have shut down the entire case right there. There would have been no case to go to the Supreme Court. So administratively, another thing I think that you put out in a paper that you wrote was that not only this scenario seems odd in terms of the 28K, but in terms of what happened to him in the course of this proceeding. Remember, at the district court level, he almost entered a consent judgment against him. But the issue of waiver, again, never came up at that point either. The only time the issue of waiver comes up was when Justice Thomas, and I think Justice Kavanaugh, asked the representatives of the two parties, what about the waiver? Is he still entitled to the waiver? And the government said, yes. And Ferrer, representing Vaello-Madero, also said yes. When he was asked, well, you'd be willing to accept the waiver today? Well, if there was a waiver, there would be no harm, right? There would be nothing to appeal. It's a very strange case in that kind of situation. But administratively, there's another issue, which I said you wrote in your paper, which was the policy of the Social Security Administration in order to keep folks, in fact, there was a phenomenon when a whole bunch of SSI recipients showed up in Poland, receiving benefits, getting the checks in Poland, not in the States. There was a regulation passed and a directive passed that says, if you receive SSI benefits and you're outside of the country, you're in a foreign country for more than 30 days, you lose those benefits. Well, what does that mean? That can only mean one thing. When SSI looked at Puerto Rico, they asked the question, is Puerto Rico a foreign country? The answer to that question should have been no, since 1898. In the case of Isabella versus Gonzalez, Puerto Rican national, Puerto Ricans were not American citizens until 1917, coming to New York to be deported back to Puerto Rico as a foreigner, went all the way to the Supreme Court. The first major Puerto Rican civil rights case. And she won. And the court held, she is not a foreigner. Puerto Rico is not a foreign country. So that should have dictated the result here immediately. It didn't. In other words, Social Security should have said, oh, yeah, but not Puerto Rico. So that becomes an issue. Was that taken up in the court? No. The court avoided the issue of standing or harm. The court avoided this issue, which is also raised in your paper, of the 30-day scenario in a foreign country. So what gets up into the Supreme Court. Okay. You get the due process, modern due process analysis that incorporates in the Fifth Amendment, in the Liberty Clause, the concept of equal protection. And as you know, there are a bunch of different tests. The highest test, strict scrutiny, suspect classification, was applied by the district court and then reversed by the First Circuit. They applied the legitimate business test, the rationally related test, an intermediate test, okay, which essentially says, when the government can show that what it's doing has a legitimate, a related purpose, then it should stand. Should not be. It just it should prevail over any attack on it. That's what got to the Supreme Court. Not what the district court had found, but what the Court of Appeals had used in terms of its test, where it said essentially the treatment of Puerto Rico is irrational. And then that pits your one group's irrationality against another group's rationality. And if I can come up with a good enough rationale, and I'm the state, I should prevail. I'm the government, I should prevail. That's the scenario.
Okay. So if that's the case, then is Puerto Rico outside of the United States?
That's a very good question. What's the holding in Downs versus Bidwell? Puerto Rico is an unincorporated territory of the United States, belonging to, but not a part of. What does that mean? That means that in international law context, the rights of the territory govern the rights of the people, versus the concept on General Assembly Resolution 1514, paren, which says self-determination belongs to all peoples, and the rights of the people should determine the rights of the territory. Why is that relevant or important? Because those are the insular cases that we just showed. The pictures we showed just now relate to the jurisprudence in 1901, in a six cases essentially saying what I just noted. Puerto Rico was an unincorporated territory, therefore the American flag, i.e. the Constitution, in all of its respects, did not follow the flag. Having taken the United States and being afraid of incorporating automatically millions of Filipinos, they came up with this ideological compromise. You are American nationals, you're not American citizens, and more importantly, even if you are American citizens, all of the Constitution doesn't automatically apply. That's the problem with the insular cases. They are both racist and wrong. Before this, you only had two statuses. You were a territory or a state. There was no twilight zone. This twilight zone now exists for over 125 years. And Puerto Rico still, and the territories that remain, Guam, Virgin Islands, etc., are all within this twilight zone. Go ahead.
Okay, well, since Puerto Rico is a part of the United States and not a foreign country, did the Social Security Administration make a mistake when it found that Vaello-Madero was outside of the United States for more than 30 days?
Well, it says that it was interpreting the statute, but the statute is not all that clear. I would say Social Security made another mistake of the many they make from time to time. And administratively, they could have cured this. Okay, now it's sanctioned. Now it's allegedly public policy. But again, the administration can go back and change its rules. It won't because of this precedent. It's just the way it is. It's if it will follow this, you know, Social Security SSR regulation, you know, interpretive bulletin, and this will be the scenario. So it's up to Congress to change this. Congress can simply say, we amend the SSI statute to explicitly include Puerto Rico. By the way, it includes Micronesia. So you can get SSI benefits in Micronesia. and they don't pay income taxes. So much for the rational related test. You know, the rational related test was that Puerto Ricans don't pay federal income taxes. That's true. But they pay federal taxes, including Social Security, in excess of seven states of the union. So we pay more taxes. And those of us who were federal employees have always paid federal taxes. And so we still have no right to vote.
Okay, so
that's the scenario.
So if the case could have been resolved at the administrative level, why wasn't it resolved at the administrative level?
Because nobody knew where everybody was. Let's go back. Vaello-Madero moved, and I don't know if this is in the record, but this is per my discussion, in terms of my research. He moved to Loíza Aldea to take care of a family relative. Loíza is the poorest, blackest town in Puerto Rico. So there are two things that are true about Vaello-Madero. One, he was and still is disabled. He was and still is poor. And SSI is an individually tested program. And yet, despite that, because he was in the state of New York, the Supreme Court says, well, Congress can distinguish between the state of New York and the territory of Puerto Rico. How about Vaello-Madero? What happened to him? That's why I think Justice Sotomayor says this scenario is cruel. Regardless of what the Supreme Court says, for the purposes of this program, he remained and remains disabled and poor. Now there's another program to which he paid into, which is the regular Social Security program, disability program. It's unclear whether he paid enough quarters sufficient to qualify under that program. If he did, he would be entitled to those benefits regardless of where he resides. Let me say that again. Regardless, this is the same program, same administrative agency, two parts, same statute, two parts. So under the regular program, you can get disability benefits sent anywhere in the world, including Poland. Under the SSI program, only in the States, according to Vaello-Madero Supreme Court decision, and not the territories. That makes no sense either. That's not rational. And yet the program was held to be rationally sustainable because Puerto Ricans don't pay their income taxes. By the way, you can't be paying federal income taxes and still be eligible for SSI. That makes no sense. To get SSI, you can't be able to work. You have to be poor. So it can't be you're getting it because you're paying federal income taxes. That can't be the requirement because it wasn't. And that makes no sense, which is what Justice Sotomayor focused in on in her dissent. Again, a strange decision justified only by Article 4, Section 3, Clause 2, allows Congress to treat Puerto differently if it has a rational basis. That's the problem set presented here. Okay. And then Justice Gorsuch, one of the most conservative justices on the court, saying all of these insular cases, okay, are rotten to the core and are racist. Which, by the way, Puerto Ricans have been saying for about 125 years.
Okay, so we talked about the insular cases, but what about the decisions in Califano v. Torres and Harris versus Rosario? Should those be used as precedent in this case?
They were. Okay, they asked counsel, you know, how many cases do we have to overrule in order to find your favor? It's a horrible question. The simple answer, which he initially gave, was all of them. Then he backtracked and said two. Which two? The ones you just mentioned. Why? Because one was basically a right to travel case. And this is not a right to travel case. And so that this would, you know, this would affect the right to travel. According to Baye, but those were summary decisions. Okay, no, none of the findings or elaborate presentations that you had here. When that has occurred previously, the court has disregarded those, has felt free to disregard them. It didn't in this case. Justice Kavanaugh said they applied, and we're just following that as well. Okay, we've decided this before on a different ground. We now decided in this on the basis of the rational related test.
Right. And didn't those cases rest on the premise that Puerto Ricans don't pay any federal income taxes?
So, like many cases that could be factually wrong, right? Because the record wasn't developed, you understand that? Okay. That's like saying in Balzac versus People of Puerto Rico 1922 case, which sustained this concept of incorporation. They're saying Puerto Ricans are not entitled to a jury trial in a criminal proceeding because they're not ready for it. And there's some language about civilized and whatever in that decision, okay? And they said the same thing in another case involving the Philippines. Minor problem with that. In 1901, Puerto Rico adopted the Criminal Code of California. Why is that? Because it's about 1878, that code was the only code in the States, both in Spanish and English. So they took this criminal code and they made it the Puerto Rico criminal code. So what was in that code, including jury trials, was in play since 1901. Similarly, the District Court of Puerto Rico, created by the United States and operational in 1901 or thereafter, was an English-speaking court where in civil cases and criminal cases, you would also get a jury trial. None of that you will find in Balzac versus People of Puerto Rico. So the facts on the ground were what? Ignored, simply not understood. Now that generally happens when you have a summary decision because you don't have complete briefing. This wasn't a summary decision. So the Supreme Court has ignored the facts on the ground on the one side of this, and on the side it has defaulted in this to this rational related test where just about anything it suffices to support what is patent discrimination. Because today, Vaello-Madero continues to be disabled and poor. Those facts have not changed.
Okay, well, it seems like the territories clause, the tax status argument, long-standing history between the United States and Puerto Rico, it seems pretty straightforward, those aspects of the case. And so why did the Supreme Court even agree to hear this case, taking all those things into consideration?
Because there is a rule of thumb. When your circuit commands that the federal government, per its decision, now expend $1 billion or more on benefits, that really is a matter that should have been taken over before Congress, right? It is legislative in the guise of being litigation. So this was a major case for the government in terms of what? Expense. We're not talking hundreds of thousands of dollars. We're now talking $1 billion or more in this instance. And it was briefed in other pending cases, other multi-billion dollar increases to the federal budget. So the Supreme Court said, let's look at this again. Should a court, should even a circuit court, have a decision that results in those kinds of expenses, which are extraordinary. And they were briefed. Okay, all of the justices were aware that this was not a case about $28,000. This case was never a case about $28,000. This case is a multi-billion dollar case. And if you don't think that commands the court's attention these days, well, let's say it does.
Okay, one thing I found interesting was Justice Thomas's concurring opinion, where he raised the idea that the citizenship clause in the 14th Amendment of the US Constitution may well prohibit the federal government from denying citizens equality with respect to civil rights. So he said, instead of invoking the Fifth Amendment's due process clause, he believes we should consider whether the citizenship clause of the 14th Amendment would yield a similar and more supportable result. Do you agree with this idea?
I don't think the court agrees. I don't think he has a majority for that. Think about the things you could say are privileges and immunities of citizens of the United States. How many things could you identify quickly as privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States? And when you think long and hard about it, you come up with one, the right to travel. And your list just begins there and ends there. So let's say this is not an area that has had a lot of Supreme Court development for a lot of different reasons. Some of them are political. So what would be the political reason the court might not be interested in this particular theory? Well, guess what? They're American citizens in American Samoa and American citizens in Guam. And we can keep going. Right? And of course, American citizens, 3.1 million of them in Puerto Rico. The impact of what this might mean for the Congress could be amazing in terms of costs. And I'm not sure the court is ready to go in that direction, this is not the first time he's talked about it. He's talked about it before as his way of getting out of the race-based 14th Amendment jurisprudence, which he also was critical of in Vaello-Madero. So it would seem to me that it sounds good on paper, but I'm not sure it's good. It has legs, constitutional legs. Would it be a good idea to afford similar rights to all American citizens? Well, of course it would be. I'm not sure it's gonna get there through this particular clause.
We mentioned that Justice Gorsuch, in his concurring opinion, said that he thought that the insular cases should be overruled. And we previously mentioned that the attorney for Vaello-Madero, Herman Ferrey, said that he didn't ask for the court to revoke the insular cases. So why do you think he didn't ask for the court to revoke the insular cases?
Yeah, I don't know, so I can't answer that question. I'm not gonna speculate. I've actually had a long conversation with him before his argument. Could have been tactical or strategic at the point of argument, and that happens. So you never want to second guess someone's decision. Even if he had asked, I don't think they needed the insular cases necessarily to do what they did, which is find a rational basis for government action, especially knowing the costs involved, which again, it's not so explicitly stated in the decision, but it's there. They knew the numbers. No one's committing them. You know, the problem, the other territories may have thousands of people living there. And costs associated with programs can run into, into the low millions. And when you're talking about 3.1 million people, where 40% of all Puerto Ricans are disabled, this program could be very expensive to the United States. Those are the relevant figures. Those are the relevant numbers. And it would seem that is what is behind this particular decision.
Justice Sotomayor, in her dissenting opinion, argued that there is no rational basis for treating needy citizens living within a territory of the United States so differently from others. So do you believe that Puerto Rico's tax status provides Congress with a rational basis to exclude residents of Puerto Rico from certain federal welfare programs?
It doesn't matter what I believe. That's what the court has held. Okay. What I believe is irrelevant. You know, the question is, how do you deal with this? How to resolve this? And again, the legislative process is the door to which the court is sending you, which is not the first time it's done that. If you want a recourse, a congressional recourse or a congressional statute, go to Congress and have them amend that statute. That's not unusual. And I think that's where the court is going with this and other cases. Let's take for a moment, if you wanted all U.S. citizens to vote for president and vice president. One way of doing that is not by going to the court, because I don't think the court is going to change the Electoral College. The way to do that is to eliminate the Electoral College. I'll allow for direct election by all American citizens, wherever they are in the world, of the president. I would add to that American nationals as well. No Electoral College, and all Americans with candidates with the most votes will win. Okay. That's a structural change. And remember, senators were elected by the state legislatures until about the 1890s. So one of the great movements, the populist movement in the 1890s, was to have direct election of senators. And the Supreme Court is about to face the state legislature issue. The way it was set up, the state legislature really is the ultimate arbiter of elections under the framework of the Constitution. That case is for the Supreme Court. And I think if that case is decided on behalf of the states and state power, you might have a movement to eliminate the Electoral College, which again take the state legislature out of the mix. Okay. So there are other issues that are surfacing as you want to have a more open what? Democracy. But again, democracy has different answers to different problems. If you want $1 billion, court is saying, go to Congress. Don't come to us, at least in this case.
Okay, so I'm curious, wouldn't statehood obviously resolve the territories clause issue?
Well, you got to read Vaello-Madero very closely for the statehood issue. And here's how that plays. If Puerto Rico was given the right to set its own tax rates as high as it wanted, because federal government knew there was no federal income tax. The highest tax rate in Puerto Rico today is around 33%. No state has that higher rate of individual taxation. No state in the country. Puerto Rico has the highest. If you add to that 33% a federal tax of 25% of your income at the highest rates, you have a whole lot of people who will be doing whatever they can to lower the Puerto Rico tax rate, because you can't lower the federal tax rate, except through Congress, to as low as they can have it. That's going to wreak havoc with every single program on the island. Nobody talks about that. They talk about, well, since most folks are poor, they won't be paying any taxes. That's not the point. Some of your most productive people would have the highest tax rates in the United States. What does that do to the economy? And does that simply propel more depopulation of young. That's not so. So the political answer to your question, sure, you get two senators and a bunch of representatives. But let's go back historically. One of the reasons Hawaii and Alaska were admitted together, though Hawaii had been asking for admission for over 100 years, was that Hawaii, then a Republican state, and Alaska, then a Democratic state, by admission would not have changed the balance of power in Congress. The theory in Congress is that Puerto Rico would come in as a Democratic state, and that would affect the balance of power in Congress, which militates against a petition for statehood at this time. None of that is discussed on the island.
Right, so eventually you would think that there will be a tipping point where Puerto Rico will become a state or it will become independent. When do you think that tipping point will come?
I don't think it has to be A or B. I think historically, and I'm going back to the 1860s, in Puerto Rico, the prevailing political norm has been some form of autonomy, whether from Spain or from the United States. And it would seem to me that although you smiled about getting rid of the Electoral College, if they got rid of the Electoral College, that would go a long way to appeasing a lot of people, that they could participate in the most important election that there is in the country. So you're a long way from saying, give it all up, and there are no other creative ways of governing. There are always creative ways of governing. The question is what people of goodwill want to do with respect to that subject. So I don't see any groundswell in Congress where you have to have it for statehood at this time. But I could see it if there was another state. DC came in as Republican and Puerto Rico is Democrat, or vice versa. DC came in as Democrat and Puerto Rico came in as Republican. I think you would then say you'd have a different argument. But I think you have to deal with the political nexus in Congress. Unless you have enough votes there, it's not happening. And you don't have enough votes at the moment even to get SSI.
In this case, before it was resolved, President Biden said that he supported giving Puerto Rico SSI benefits as a matter of law and policy. And there's always been the balance of power between the Supreme Court and the president. Why doesn't the president just come in and say and keep his word?
You gotta ask him that, right? The administration did submit a legislative amendment package for SSI being extended to Puerto Rico in this Congress. Remember, once the Congress ends, in the new Congress, you'd have to resubmit. And with the Republican House, you may not get there, or you may get that. You'd have to have the votes either way. So you don't necessarily have the votes right now. In fact, this Congress still has the possibility of passing that legislation, whether it will, they got until the end of their term, right?
Recently, there was a case out of American Samoa that specifically asked the court to overrule the insular cases.
And but you had the American Samoan government opposed to the case.
Yeah.
Saying the insular cases were not really all that racist, whatever that means. Just go read them on your own to see what they really are. And saying they didn't want American citizenship to the Supreme Court. So when the territory's government is selling to the Supreme Court in its amicus brief, we don't even want this to happen. Why would you go to to that political hot potato. Why would you touch it? Okay. So there was a diverse opinion there. Whether or not you should be compelled to be American citizens. Puerto Ricans were given American citizenship in 1917. And if you didn't want it, you had to go hire a lawyer notary to sign an affidavit, expensive, difficult process to do to avoid getting American citizenship. When Louisiana territory was adopted, people there were American citizens, Texas, American citizens, California, Americans, it was automatic. It's only when the insular cases come that you don't automatically get American citizenship. So that's one of the defaults of the insular cases. So you can see why they would be arguing, don't touch it, we like the insular cases. It lets us be what we are, which is American nationals, and we don't want to be American citizens, quote unquote, and whatever else, what other obligations might ensue. Okay. So that's one of those where you, the politics of these cases matter in all of these cases. The Supreme Court is well aware of where these divisions lie and tries to take only 70 cases a year judiciously, I mean, only those cases that best things it can solve or resolve or wants to address.
Okay, so and in the future, do you think that the Supreme Court actually has any real interest in overruling the insular cases, no. As Gorsuch said?
No, I think Gorsuch and has one, two. I think he got three or four votes. I think you need five. You get a fifth vote, you got it. Okay, I am all for overruling the insular cases. That doesn't mean Puerto Rico ceases to be a territory. It only means the Constitution should be applied across the board. And then that opens the next question, right? I did say to you that there's a jury trial in Puerto Rico in criminal proceedings, and there is. And most recently, the Supreme Court held that those trials have to be unanimous. The Puerto Rico Constitution had a gag law provision that provided for non-unanimous juries in order to suppress dissent on the island in the 1950s. That provision became inoperative once the Supreme Court said these juries have to make their findings unanimous, which makes perfectly good sense across the entire country. In the civil law proceedings in state court in Puerto Rico, there is no jury trial. And there has never been a jury trial. So a good question that comes up to, there is a bill filed recently, a few weeks ago, to compel jury trials in civil proceedings in Puerto Rico. But let's do the hypothetical. Assuming we get rid of the insular cases, does that mean the Seventh Amendment applies in Puerto Rico and compels a jury trial in civil cases? I would hope so. But there are a lot of Puerto Ricans who believe other than that. So there's a conflict, yet unresolved.
I have one last question. During the oral arguments, Justice Breyer asked about the Federal Relations Act and asked whether this law is not locally inapplicable. And I noticed that in the decision, they didn't really fault, Breyer didn't write an opinion, and no one addressed that issue. But I was wondering if this Social Security, this SSI income should apply to Puerto Rico because it's not locally inapplicable.
Nobody knows what those words mean. You look at all the case law, it's all over the place. What do they mean? I think they know what it doesn't mean. What it doesn't mean is Puerto Rico does not get to say no when the federal government says yes to a particular statute. I think they know that much. But the First Circuit, Puerto Rico belongs to the First Circuit for appellate purposes, federal appellate purposes. Virgin Islands, which is literally a few miles next to Puerto Rico, belongs to the Third Circuit, Philadelphia. That makes no sense. if you're making any sense, I guess we would be tied to Florida, the closest to Florida, that circuit, neither the first or third. The First Circuit under Justice, under Holmes, Oliver Wendell Holmes, created a doctrine, the Supreme Juridic, the First Circuit itself, looking at the Puerto Rico cases, said, well, to the extent that there are civil cases and civil law, we will defer to Puerto Rico judgment, including the Supreme Court of Puerto Rico. And we will not substitute common Anglo-Saxon law, which I argue in a law review article created a doctrine of judicial economy, judicial autonomy. Puerto Rico was autonomous in that sense. It could develop its own legal system, which it did and continues to do. So the First Circuit judges, and that includes Breyer, are educated by their constant contact with Puerto Rico cases to the importance of allowing the island to maintain its own sui generis development of civil law. Criminal law, another issue because of what I said earlier. And so locally inapplicable also speaks to that, right? To the extent that it's not in conflict with the civil law of Puerto Rico, well then fine. When there is a conflict, we will try to avoid that conflict. Pull out. So it's a lot of magic words that nobody really has spelled out or used in any truly affirmative fashion. So you're not going to get a lot of ambiguity there. You're not going to get a lot of clarity there. And I think Breyer used it. He's in a number of cases, continued to say, nobody would listen to him because I don't think anybody understood the way he understands. And First Circuit justices, Oliver Wendell Holmes ended up on the Supreme Court. So he had this sense, he's written, I mean, there was opinion after opinion written by him. He's in all of those cases. Okay, judge below, you did it wrong. You know, apply the civil law. A very interesting set of cases that you don't normally read or study in the States. So I would think that that language that you spoke speaks to what I'm talking about, although it doesn't mention it. But I think Breyer really understands this. Okay. Don't mess with the civil law. Unless you have to, don't mess with the civil law. No one's done that. No one's done that. Okay. And so in American, in Puerto Rico law schools, you learn the civil law from Spain, the Napoleon Code. Okay. Different way of looking at the world. Where you don't, there is no split between common law and equity because there's no common law equity split in civil law. So it's a different world protected, interestingly enough, by what you're citing, the Federal Relations Act. Okay. But I'm not sure that was its purpose.
Okay, well, this has been an excellent conversation about the case of U.S. versus Vaello-Madero. Thank you very much, Mr. Del Valle, for being here today. We appreciate your contribution to this discussion, and we would be happy to have you again for another discussion in the future.
Great. Thank you. Take good care.
Thank you.